morning, everyone. First, I would like to thank the organizer of this this meeting to with your hard work, which come to this beautiful island for this fantastic meeting. What are Taiwanese supernovae? We know that Taiwanese supernovae are thermonuclear explosions of carbon oxygen reservoirs with a mass close to the Chandrasekhar mass limit. For a white dwarf with about 1.4 grams carbon is ignited under degenerate conditions, and this will lead to the thermonuclear runaway, and this will result in the incineration, the complete destruction of the host town with large amount of energy, 10 to 51 Earths. But as we know, most of the white dwarfs have a mass of about 0.6 grams. Actually, from a single stellar evolution point of view, the maximum mass for a white dwarf is something about 1.05 grams. It's less than 1.1 grams. So in order to increase white dwarf mass to the Chandrasekhar mass, we need aggregation. So how mass is aggregated on the white dwarf, and how when white dwarf is exploded, so we will do something here. Here I show some examples of white dwarf aggregation. They were symbiotic boundaries, low mass average boundaries, and supersonic resources, AM series stars, etc. Here, that's a figure by Nomoto. This shows how mass will be aggregating onto white dwarf. So, here in this region, if the mass transfer rate is quite low, in this case, it will result in nova explosion. That means the white dwarf mass may not increase, it may rather decrease. If the mass transfer rate is quite high, in this case, the white dwarf will evolve to a radiant structure. So, and only in this tiny region for the mass transfer rate, the aggregation material can burn steadily at the surface of the white dwarf. So that means this channel is very inefficient for producing Taiwan supernovae. Hachizu, to solve this problem, Hachizu proposed the optimist thick model. In this case, in this region, the white dwarf increases mass at a critical rate, and the unprocessed material will be blown away by the wind. We calculate the white dwarf, aggregation come out, and first we do something simple. We calculate the carbon oxygen aggregation, material aggregation on the carbon oxygen white dwarf. This is written down by Chen Shiganda give a talk here. So, say for a white dwarf of 0.8 solar mass with a cooling age of 10 to 8 years, we see that this is a figure of temperature and density. Temperature, the measured temperature in a white dwarf, and that's the corresponding density. We show that at the beginning of the aggregation, the density and the temperature become higher and higher. Then carbon started to burn, and they went off, start with expand a little bit. Then there is, it will reach a point where the density does not change, but the temperature increases sharply. That means the carbon burning temperature is shorter than the convective temperature. In this case, we define it as the ignition point. That's how the that's where the historian starts. Here let us show two profiles of density and temperature profiles. That's for a point A thermals and of aggregation. But this one, you can see one has a center ignition here. But the other one has an off-center ignition because this one of initially has a much longer, much bigger cooling age. The cooling age for this has one vertical year, the cooling age for this for vertical year. So this shows an example of the aggregation process of one thermos red dwarf. You can see that at the beginning, and that's the ignition point. You can see that as aggregation proceeds, the energy that's released by the aggregation is mainly global thermal energy transfer from outside to inside, and the inner part, the temperature of the inner part increase, later this will be ignited. Also, we do something similar for heating material aggregation. We find some similar results. So here, that's carbon dioxide aggregating at 10 to minus 6 solar mass per year. You see, we also get ignition point here, and also get a central ignition. We did a lot of calculations for this. We found a three region. If the mass transfer rate is low here, that would result in NOVA. If mass transfer is high, that would be red jet. But here, if we have optical sequence, then we find it also. Although in this region, that's the helium-rich material burns steadily at the surface of carbon oxygen white walls. The thing interesting we found is we have a critical rate here. So if the helium material, the aggregation rate of helium material is lower than this, then this may result in type I supernova. But if over than this, it's not carbon which burn off center quite steadily. This will result in oxygen near white dwarf. And that's a chemical structure, chemical profile of this white dwarf at the carbon ignition. So this part is the original, the initial white dwarf. This part is the mass increase. So such model maybe can be used for the white dwarf explosion. And also we carry the parameter space for the aggregation of white dwarf, the helium aggregation of helium from helium star on the white dwarf, and this is the parameter space. There's something new here that this, at this part, I mean that the initial white dwarf, that's the initial the helium star mass, that's one method in this part that will result in oxygen near white dwarf, not the type of a supernova. we also, okay, we got to do something for hydrogen accretion, because this is something, it takes much longer time. We have not finished that the not the evolution, but hydrogen burn is has some hidden flash. So that's the chemical proof that we can see carbon is produced by the accretion. So here we have some for the per general model, normally we have single digital channel with vital and then that's from a missing star or from a red star or a hidden star or double digital model. So we use a binary algorithm code to carry the parameter space for the channels, and then we call the birth rate here. That the observation are from totality time, and the dot line here, that's from white dwarf and matter from a hidden star, white dwarf and matter from red jet. And the dashed line here, that's from double white dwarf module. We see here the white dwarf plus the symbolic channel that are quite inefficient. But with the shielded work, this we increase by a factor of 100. So also, that's something about super energy emission from early time galaxies. This is a super energy image that all the points socket are. So people have been speculating the super-energy are from white dwarf collision white dwarf. So that's the spectrum of the accretion white dwarf, and that was being speculated that the evolution of super-energy emission here at this. And those observations are from SM Newton channel. Also, you see, for upwind six-wind model, there's something not quite happy. There are different magnetity, the gravity is too high, so we just invented complementary loop wind model. This model can see multiple booster at the back of this meeting. So let's conclude. Accretion of old Matthew white dwarfs will lead to off-center ignition in the hidden accretion to AIC in the many channels. We currently have a super knowledge in the accretion white dwarfs in BUT to make the results of ignition of early type galaxies in the common wind model can be viable for white dwarf accretion. Thank you very much.
I think your wind model is very interesting. What are the typical densities and speeds of your wind?
In the wind or the density of
what? From the break of the system. Where's the mass loss rate?
Much harder. That the question would be maybe for the common event wind model. Maybe what can
the common overall density?
Because the nuclear density is very high, and then the temperature may expand to a very huge range. And for most cases, the temperature might be about 10 to minus 4 to 10 to the minus 3 solar line. So it's the density is very, very low.
Thank you.